been married for quite a while. Got a bunch of kids doing faith in style. They'll tell you that you're awesome and you're not alone.
So let's start the show.
Who knew Catholics could be so much fun? Greg and Jennifer and how faith is done. Screwing up and trying and forgiving. Adventures in imperfect living. Adventures in imperfect living.
Greetings, folks. I'm Greg Willits from gregandjennifer.com and rosaryarmy.com.
And I'm Jennifer Willits, his wife.
Coming up on episode 327 of Adventures in Imperfect Living.
Mass is coming back, albeit filled with restrictions.
The story of why we don't scare people in our house.
I surprised Greg with a Christmas gift on a rosary live stream.
5 months late. What to do when you feel like you've had it with the bishops.
We'll tell you how to see a happy Jesus.
And a whole lot more. So grab your Lysol and stay 6 feet away. Episode 327 is starting right now.
Adventures in a perfect living.
Of course, at the beginning of the show, we have to thank our Patreon co-producers, all of you who have helped us either through your financial support or your prayer support. Both are so appreciated. If you want to help us through your financial support, of course, you can do so by becoming a co-producer. It's just like $5 a month or more if you want. And at $5 a month, you get access to things like what we did last week, which we'll talk about, this cool live stream meetup that we did, as well as other bonus things when we create them. So you can go over to patreon.com, that's patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer. Sign up at $5. You get instant digital access to over 100 exclusive pieces of content. If you sign up at more than that, at $10 or more, you'll get swag in the mail and other cool things. Go check out all of the things that we offer over at patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer. So we're recording this on a Monday morning, and we started it probably at one of the, it's a convenient time for us, but it's one of the worst times for the rest of the household, because even though it's just after 10 o'clock, our children have not yet started to come out of their various catacomb sleeping areas, and so it's going to get loud. I know at some point, and so I'm already telling myself, don't worry about it. Don't worry about that. You're going to hear a dog come running down the stairs when Tom wakes up. You're going to hear doors being shut way too loudly at some point. And so when you hear thumps and clunks and chunks, they haven't eaten breakfast yet. And so we're going to hear microwave doors getting slammed, even though they've been instructed, please be quiet, because we're doing a podcast. And we're, you know, now that we moved our podcast recording stuff out into the middle of basically everything, we're sort of getting what we asked for. Which is, how do you avoid noise like this? And so thank you for your patience throughout the course of this.
Maybe look at it this way. It's proof that you are, in fact, a father.
Well,
isn't that a very positive?
Hey, listen.
Sounds of life.
They provide so much other proof. I don't need that. Listen.
Greg, you are not alone. Isn't that's our sign off of the show.
Don't forget, you are annoyed and you're not alone.
That is not on our tagline.
That's the tagline of the podcast that I listen to. You're not, don't forget, until next time, you're annoyed and you're not alone. Thanks. Yeah.
It's just, you know, these are very understandable household noises that remind us that we are honoring our vocation as parents.
When did you start to be
holy like this?
No.
Oh my gosh. It goes way back. Okay.
When in your life, I mean, I guess for me, it's like it was drilled into my head as a kid, don't wake up dad, and being quiet, that kind of thing. And maybe part of it was because of, and have I ever told the story about why we don't scare people in our family, why we don't jump out and startle people because of what my father did to me when I was in sixth grade? Have I ever shared that story?
Go ahead and share it, because it doesn't matter how I answer the question.
Have I shared that before?
On a podcast, I doubt. If you did, it literally would have been years ago.
All right, so go back in time. I became an uncle.
This is going to explain Greg's current state of mind.
Well, I mean, it goes through why
this is his evidence.
Number one, this is my evidence. Number one, that why I tend to be overly respectful of other people's silence. Like when I leave our bedroom, when you're still sleeping, I mean, when I go to turn the doorknob, most of the time I'm like on a 5 second click, 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 turn. Okay, now open the door, open, quiet. Now release it. Don't release the doorknob too fast because it's going to make a click and then go on to the other side of the door and do it in reverse and shut. I mean,
when someone is sleeping.
When you're sleeping.
Okay, yeah. Of course. Yeah, that's a very kind, respectful, considerate way of entering and exiting a bedroom with a sleeping loved one.
Whereas with our children, it's, you know, okay, hey, where's that spoon? All right, where's that glass? All right. And when I was a kid, I never did that kind of thing. To my knowledge, I don't recollect it. And part of it is because I remember always being told, like, if Dad was sleeping, it's because he had to get up super early for a flight or something like that. And Dad needed to go to bed because he'd get up at 3 o'clock in the morning. And so it was always like, be super quiet. And I understood that. So I became an uncle when I was in sixth grade. The day after my 12th birthday, my niece Abby was born. And shortly thereafter, her dad went to school for a trade. And he was going to be trained to do this certain thing. Well, so they all moved to like Oklahoma City or something like that. And they were living in a little furnished apartment. And my brother-in-law was so focused on this teaching and everything. And it was like a really intense trade school for 6 months or something like that. I don't remember the details. And they had a newborn baby, this brand new baby, Abby. And so my sister is trying to keep this newborn, like an infant, like a month or two old, trying to keep her quiet while her dad is studying. Well, it became very stressful. And so the decision was made. My sister and my niece left Oklahoma, came, and we were living in Ohio at the time, came and stayed with us in Ohio while my brother-in-law finished this trade school for like 2 months or something like that, right? So Abby is in the house, this little baby. Got to keep everyone quiet. Got to be quiet because I remember it was a Sunday night. Dad had to get up like at 3 o'clock for a flight the next morning, and Abby was sleeping. You wake up the baby. If a baby's screaming, there's no way Dad's going to be sleeping. And so here's the other complication. The bathroom that my brother and I used was, we had to walk through my parents' bedroom to get to the bathroom. That was the toilet we were allowed to use.
So their personal bathroom, yeah,
exactly,
space for that room.
For that room. There was no other door to get to that bathroom, but that was the bathroom that we were supposed to use. So, it was my, you know, that's just, there was another bathroom, but that was my mom's rule. You know, the other one was like a guest bathroom. I don't know. It was the.
She can hide your filth far easier.
It was to hide our filth. I was quiet, but I was nasty. Okay. So now all the pieces have been laid. Right. Keep it quiet. Baby in the house. Dad goes to sleep early. Bathroom, had to go through my parents' bathroom or bedroom to get to the bathroom. So it's Sunday night, dark. Walk into my parents' bedroom. Dad's sleeping. He's laying in the bed. It's Sunday. Dad, in the morning, after church, liked to read the paper, and he would just take the papers, the newspaper, and drop the sections on the floor. So as I'm walking past my parents' bed to get to the bathroom door, which was on my dad's side of the room, so I had to walk right past where my dad was sleeping, where he had littered like mines in a minefield, pieces of newspaper. You step on newspaper. I'm going to wake up Dad. So I'm walking in there.
And just set the scene. It's like what it's time dark. Of the night?
It's like, it's probably
middle
only,
of the night?
No, it's probably only like 8:30 at night. It's probably only like 8 or 8:30. But Dad had to get up at 3, you know, be at the airport at 3 o'clock or something like that.
So the lights were out.
It's pitch black. Okay. It's winter time, right? So it's pitch black.
Okay.
Dark room. And I'm staring intently at the floor, trying to make out where are the pieces of newspaper. And I'm stepping in between the spaces, in between the newspaper, like I'm a soldier walking through a minefield, and any one of these could go off in a colossal explosion that's going to wake up my father, who's literally about 2 feet away from me to my left. So I'm cautiously taking steps. I'm trying to walk through the steps, trying to be super quiet. Don't wake up Dad. Don't let him know I'm in there, because all I have to do is take a leak.
How old were you at this point?
12.
Okay.
12 years old. I just turned 12 a few months before. And I am halfway past the mine.
Looking like a ninja in the dark.
I'm halfway through the minefield of the newspapers. And so I still have newspapers. Now I'm in the middle of it. Now I have newspapers in all directions. One bad step in any direction could wake up Dad. And I'm sitting there and I'm laser focused, intent, and I'm sitting there and I'm trying to stand and then take another step. And as I'm about to take another step, all of a sudden from my left, the sheets went flying into the air, thrown up as my father went, "Roar!" My father, who I thought was sleeping, that suddenly came alive and screamed and just started, "Roar!" And I started to scream and scream, and this unending scream just kept coming out of my mouth. And Dad suddenly realized, what have I done? And in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, Abby is across the hall. I'm going to wake up the baby. Dad's awake. I stepped on the paper. I got to pee. Dad's like, "It's okay. It's okay. It's okay." And Dad said, "No one will ever jump out and scare anyone ever again in this house. It's not allowed anymore. You cannot scare anyone ever, ever, ever again." Wow. And it was at that moment that all damage to Greg's brain was done.
I'm about to say, I think we all now know the source of your PTSD is your dad.
And so
he broke Greg's brain that day.
I remember.
Accidentally.
And then it was like, you just don't jump out and scare people. You just don't do that. It's very funny. It is very funny.
Yes. It was a great practical joke.
But I'm serious. I could not. I remember sitting there going, I can't stop the screaming coming out of my mouth.
You were that shook up by the experience of the fright.
And I remember thinking so clearly, I'm going to wake up Abby. I'm going to wake her up. And yet the screams are still coming out of my mouth. And then, of course, you know, you'd think it would be the most satisfying urination ever when I finally got to the bathroom. I have no memory of that.
You don't even remember peeing anymore.
I might have peed right at that moment. And somehow that's been blocked from my memory. There's a good chance that might have been like the last time Greg peed his pants.
Well, hey, there was a newspaper all over the ground. It was perfect. Just pee on the paper.
And I assume Dad made his flight the next morning. I have no idea. So all that to say, I don't even know
how. It's difficult to be a good dad.
So that's all goes back to saying, I'm always very sensitive about, just be quiet. Just listen, I'm not asking you to walk through minefields of newspaper. Just don't slam the door when you're going to the bathroom. It's not necessary. And we're recording it, so you don't have to make so much noise. I know it's possible, and I'm not going to jump out and scare you when you're trying to remain quiet. So this morning we're getting up, having our coffee, getting ready, trying to get ourselves in the mindset of podcasting. And lo and behold, as I'm scanning the news sites, as I do every morning, suddenly I saw this one amazing notification, the Archdiocese of Atlanta making the announcement finally after all of this time and shutdown, quarantine, social distancing, a potential return to Mass is right around the corner.
With a date, with guidelines, with as many answers to all the hundreds of questions the faithful are not going to be like, well, what about this? What about that? How are we going to do this? So talk about almost feeling, I don't know about you, Greg, but I was almost like hard to breathe. Like it was the excitement that you feel for such good news. It's like, okay, calm down. Let me just read. You have to read it once for shock value. And then you got to go back and go slower and read it again and look for the fine details and the memo that came out from our he's an archbishop, right?
Yeah. He's been installed. We have a new archbishop as of like a couple weeks ago. Archbishop Gregory Hartmeyer is now our official Archbishop of Atlanta. And so he was the bishop in Savannah. And so in the midst of all of this, a lot of the announcements that came through were affecting all of the state of Georgia by decree of the dioceses of Savannah and the Archdiocese of Atlanta. And so all that together, and part of it, I have to believe, part of the decisions that were being made was because of the complexity of the installation of the archbishop in the middle of all of this, that things were going to be changing anyway. And so we needed to have him move from Savannah over to here and then trying to figure out from that. And so they, you know, considering the fact that he was installed just a couple weeks ago, they did, I think, put it in place fairly quickly.
Yeah.
Given all the news and everything else that's been happening right now. And I also wonder if part of the reason for the delay was because there wasn't an archbishop because of that transition was happening right when Governor Kemp said, you know, we could start opening up Georgia a little bit more. And so now I'm not surprised by the timing of it, but getting this, and you said you're holding your breath as you're reading this, I kind of had a different effect in reading the memo that came out. And there was a longer communique that went out to the priests, and then there was sort of a summary memo that was put out. And we share this, even though it has to do with the Archdiocese of Atlanta, we share it because they actually used some of this. They got some of this from other dioceses. For example, the Diocese of Lafayette in Louisiana, how did they bring things back in? And so I imagine all of the dioceses, having worked for a couple archdioceses, knowing that they tend to look at what are other dioceses doing, sure, and learning from each other and then trying to you know, combine best practices and that kind of thing. And so when I was reading it, I was kind of like not so much with bated breath as much as I was looking for nuance and just going, okay, all right. I was a little bit more snarky in my approach to it. I was like, just kind of looking at it and going, I'm looking for how are they going to handle what is the archdiocesan speak that is going to be coming out of this? Maybe a little bit more jaded of a view, because I've read a lot of these things before they become public knowledge, right? In past jobs, where I kind of like I get the chancery speak that's in there,
okay,
and I'm just going, okay, what's the truth behind the words? And for the most part, I thought it was pretty forthright. I thought they really tried to cover as much as they could. I do feel like about halfway through, I was like, boy, talk about crossing every T and dotting every I. It's almost like they were putting extra crosses and extra dots on the I's and the T's that weren't necessary about halfway through. I was like, well, it's, you know, I like, for example, one of the things was like, you know, it is recommended that before the faithful return to Mass, that all members of the household take their temperature at home before they,
And if
anyone
happen.
Has higher than a 99 point, I can't imagine us lining up at the door with a thermometer going, all right, everybody. Beep. All right. Yeah. Beep.
No, you're right. I mean,
you kid, the way you've been behaving, bend over.
You're getting arrested.
This is how we're taking your temperature. You've been a pain in mine. I'm going to be a pain in yours right now.
Sad to say, you know, I don't even think we have a rectal thermometer in this house, so that would be tough to do.
If we had a rectal thermometer in this house,
it'd be a one-time use.
Yeah, I don't think I would ever use any thermometer in the house. If I just knew that a rectal thermometer existed in the house, I would never take my temperature out of fear that I would accidentally use that one.
Well, see, you and I actually have the memory of having gotten our temperature taken that way. But our children, they thought we were crazy when we tried to describe that to them. It's like,
I never had my temperature taken that way, but
probably when you were a baby, you probably did. Most moms did in the 70s. That's just kind of what it was. But anyway, we digress. We don't mean to give you visuals of rectal thermometer taking. We're trying to talk about really good news.
So wherever you are right now, just imagine Greg and Jennifer. No. Stop it. Happy puppies playing in a field. Happy puppies playing in a field. So all these kind of details, and we're not going to go through them all, but there were certain things that, you know, how to prepare the churches and other buildings. And the thing that stuck out to us the most, and there was also a video that the Archdiocese of Atlanta created, I'm assuming over the last few days, that went out with this memo. It's kind of funny because the video link was like hidden in the bottom of this memo, and there was no mention of the video anywhere in the memo itself. So it's sort of like, it looked like the CC that you see at the bottom of a letter. I imagine most people aren't even going to notice that video was there. But they showed a lot of how you prepare the church. So one of the things, temporarily removing materials from pews and chairs. So all the hymnals, all the missalettes, all the Bibles, all the pens, all any information.
Anything that you can touch.
Yeah, anything you can touch.
That's a loose thing.
So get rid of all that.
Yeah.
Having sanitizer stations at different parts in the chapel itself. But it was the receiving of the Eucharist that...
That's a tough one.
This was the most complicated. So let's explain a few things. Okay, so if the Eucharist is, as we believe, the body, blood, soul, and divinity of our Lord, we have, and you've probably picked this up through our podcast over the last year or so, that we have had, for ourselves, a deepening of how we feel we are called personally to receive the Eucharist. Meaning, we have stopped receiving the Eucharist on the hand. Now, when I was a kid, again, another story about my dad, we actually, at that same time when he scared the bejeebers out of me, we attended a Newman Center on the campus of The Ohio State University. And we thought it was such a neat thing in the late 70s and early 80s that they used unleavened bread. They had loaves of bread that they used at Mass, like actual loaves of bread. And the priest would pinch off pieces of the bread, and that was the Eucharist that we used. Well, that kind of bread, tons of crumbs, tons of fragments. And again, it was that time frame in the church. There was not, you know, again, I was in my 20s before it really became clear to me. No. What we believe, what you've been doing your whole life as a Catholic and going up and saying, body of Christ, amen. It is the body of Christ. It is the body of Jesus Christ.
It's not a symbol.
And so, but when I was a kid, it was just this thing that we did. And so when we would receive the Eucharist in this bread, actual bread form, not a host, but you know, bread, it was a neat thing. It was neat. Oh, isn't that neat? It wasn't, mm-hmm. Oh my God, literally. Oh my God. But I remember going up and following my father who would receive in the hand. And I remember dad walking back to his seat and always poking a finger into his palm of his hand and picking up the fragments on his finger and then putting those fragments in his mouth. I don't think I did that as a kid, but I remember seeing my dad do that. Another moment at that same church in sixth grade, a few months before the frightening moment, another sister got married, a different sister, at that Newman Center. And our dear friend, Father Leo Stelton, who was the priest who married off you and me, married off my sister, married off one of my brothers, we had that kind of bread at my sister's wedding, the actual little loaves of bread. And afterwards, I remember everyone was heading down the street to the hotel for the reception, and Father Leo is back in the sacristy, and he said, Greg, come here. Now, Father Leo, again, I can't explain how dear of a friend he was. At our house every Sunday for dinner, stayed at our house to recuperate when he had surgeries. I mean, just dear, dear friend. And up until his death, just a year and a half ago, my parents would spend vacations with him, that kind of thing. And he pulled me in the sacristy and he says, help me finish this. Because there was like a whole loaf of bread still there.
And you cannot put that in a tabernacle,
but I did, I'm guessing. I'm 12. Yeah. I don't know.
You don't know anything.
And Father's like, I can't, you know, he's like,
this is a lot of bread.
But he realizes you can't leave this behind.
Right.
And it wasn't then at 12 years old that I understood that, but 17 years later at 30, that I went, oh, that's why Father Leo was so concerned about this. Mm-hmm. So it's little moments like that kind of stuck with me. So now, and then as an adult, even when I continued to receive on the host, when I did understand it's the body, blood, soul, and divinity, and I would still receive Jesus on the hand, part of it was because I had so many instances where, and again, I'm a tall guy. I'm 6'4", 6'5". I don't know how tall I am now that I think I've hit the starting to shrink phase.
Yeah.
That short, extraordinary ministers, the Most Holy Eucharist, aren't very good about giving communion on the tongue. I'll just say that is a broad stroke categorization.
Now, why are short Eucharistic ministers not... Well,
if I'm standing...
You mean too tall people.
Too tall people, excuse me.
Yes, that's the rest of the statement that needs to come out.
Yeah. To tall people. I don't know how many tongue or how many thumbs have been rubbed against my tongue. And I'm just like, listen, this is, it's just frustrating to me when I'm trying to stay in a focused place and I'm sticking my tongue out as far as I can. And someone's trying to reach up and like trying to slam dunk the Eucharist in my mouth. Cause I'm as tall as a basketball pole to them. That's uncomfortable. However, I do believe, and again, I'll throw this out there, and I know that some people are extraordinary ministers of the Most Holy Eucharist. There's an important word in that phrase, in that title, extraordinary, meaning in extraordinary circumstances, and yet that's not how we treat it in the church. I think a lot of people just say, well, I'm a Eucharistic minister. It's supposed to be an extraordinary minister of Most Holy Communion, meaning if it is extraordinary circumstance and it's needed, then that person can provide the Eucharist or distribute the Eucharist. I think it should be more extraordinary. I would be more than happy with Mass going 5 minutes longer if only the priests and deacons were distributing. That's my strong feeling.
Right, because the teaching is their hands are consecrated to distribute our Lord.
They've had a lot more training, a lot more education. They have a lot more perspective and a lot more responsibility for that Eucharist. And so it's very rare when I have received the Eucharist on the tongue from a priest or deacon. And I would say,
it's rare that you've received.
I haven't finished.
Okay.
And they haven't. And it's rare that I've received from them where their fingers have ended up in my mouth.
Okay.
They somehow, because they've done it so much more, exponentially more than an extraordinary minister does as well, they just are better practiced at distributing the Eucharist. And so now here's going back to this, where in this video that we saw, take into consideration all the crumbs and all that. And so I, you know, even in my adult life, I have received the regular host in my hand and I will do what my dad did. And I will, you know, poke, you look down at your hand and there's a fragment. Now, is that fragment useless? Or is that a fragment of a host that is Jesus Christ? Are you just going to brush your hands off? Are you going to rub it on your pants? Are you going to put your hand in your pocket and it goes to the wash? Jesus is there. And if we're going to go to adoration of the Blessed Sacrament, if we're going to get down on our knees and bow before the Eucharist, then that crumb makes a difference as well. And that's kind of the mindset that brought us to finally realize we need to be receiving on the tongue. And so in the past year, that is something that we've started to do. Jennifer, you've gotten to the point where you even have started receiving not only on the tongue, but kneeling. I have not begun to do that yet. I still, because my clarity is not there yet. I have not yet been able to fully, I don't know. It's not there yet, but it's getting there. It's, you know, I've read in several places. I think Dan Burke has done a great job of really educating people on it's the most extreme form of humility before our Lord.
Yeah.
That you are humble enough before our Lord that you are willing to kneel before the Lord, so humble before the Lord that you realize that you are not even worthy to receive the Lord in your hands,
or aren't even on the same level.
Or even the same level. Yeah. And so all these things going into consideration.
Right. You know, a couple things there. In addition to, you know, the fragments, the issue of our Lord in the form of the Eucharist host that we are so accustomed to in this day and age in our country, there are still fragments. It doesn't even matter if you see it or not. The microscopic fragments are still there. And many, many bishops have confirmed this. And it is a huge problem then when the faithful are no longer regarding what is on their hands, and their hands are just free to do whatever. It's a mindless activity with your hands. Either they go prayer position or you're rubbing your face or whatever, just like you were saying. The other issue with hands is that we in this age of now coronavirus and germ transfers, and we are being repeatedly told, wash your hands, sanitize your hand, wash your hand, sanitize your hand, because experts and doctors know how dirty our hands are all the time. We're constantly touching our face. We're constantly touching surfaces. Our hands are always largely impure. So think about that dynamic as we are receiving our Lord in a dirty, like physically dirty hands. You know, so that's another element of, can we avoid that? Can we make, is there any way we can do this better? Yes, go back to the original distribution method of on the tongue. You know, you're not licking surfaces all over the world with your tongue, so it is actually cleaner
well, most than of us
the surface
aren't.
Of your hands.
Most right. of us aren't.
Right. So, and again, Dan Burke explains this very, very well. And he is so more well-researched in the teachings and the history of the church on this teaching of receiving on the tongue versus the hand. So there's no point to sort of relive all of that and restate all that. But all of that is still in the back of our minds. And so I have been really wanting to hone in on the Archdiocese of Atlanta's, what are they going to recommend? And there is this growing concern that the reception of the Eucharist is not going to be as reverent as it should be in this new age of coming back from the virus.
Well, with all that, and then the video that we saw.
Yeah.
And they're showing, you know, you keep 6 feet in between.
Which we expected.
People or family groups when you go up to receive the Eucharist. But in the video, everyone is wearing a mask as they're walking up to receive the Eucharist. And then here's the tricky thing. Okay, so imagine you have your left hand out. Your left hand is where you receive the Eucharist in your hand. If your dominant hand is your right hand, your left hand is out. If you're left-handed, then flip-flop it. But your less dominant hand is the hand in which you receive the Eucharist. Your dominant hand is cupped underneath. This is how we are taught to receive in the hand. So now, your fingers and your hand have no fragments of the Eucharist anywhere. You're wearing a mask that has straps that go around your ears. It's covering your mouth. Now, the priest or the celebrant or the deacon or whoever places the Eucharist in your hand while you're wearing a mask. In the video, then people would take a step to the side. And while they take that step to the side, now they remove their mask. So they still have the Eucharist in their hand. They remove like that, you know, one ear off of the mask. They reach down, pick up the Eucharist, you know, with a thumb and two fingers of their right hand, place it in their mouth. Okay. The mask is now half off the face. Needs to be put back on. Are there fragments on the fingers? Are there fragments on the thumb? Are there fragments still in the left hand? As you go and put the mask with the same fingers that you just held the Eucharist right, with.
Because it's your dominant hand.
As you go and touch the elastic band with the fingers and thumb that you just touched the Eucharist with, that you have not yet had a chance to look to see if Jesus is there. Now, perhaps someone might say, well, you're overthinking it. And it's like, well, Jesus would understand. This is Jesus. This is the body of Christ. If you ever saw Passion of the Christ, one of the most moving scenes in the entire thing was after the scourging at the pillar, his mother Mary taking towels and wiping up the precious blood off the ground. That's what's in those fragments. That same presence is in those fragments. Those specks, those crumbs, those little dots of the Eucharist, it's still there. So what should be done? There are some people arguing, well, if we have to wear masks and if we have to receive in the hands, that we shouldn't. Even still, we shouldn't. And instead, you should make a spiritual communion because that would be the more humble thing to do. And I don't have the answers to it. I don't know if I would be able to resist receiving Jesus at that point after such a long period of time that I would say, well, I'll make an excuse in this time and I will receive in the hand, but there's something
right.
There's something that makes me so uncomfortable about it.
Now, the real struggle.
Let me say one last thing. I just worry about what fragments are being left on that elastic or on that mask as you reposition right. it after you receive it, and then that thing goes in the wash.
Because we've introduced a new element of there's like another transaction that's now occurring that didn't used to be there. Those Catholics who are strong supporters of receiving our Lord only on the tongue, one of their biggest complaints is that it's too many transactions occurring if you receive on the hand. That's why they're trying to minimize those transactions. It goes from hand to hand, from hand to mouth, and then, you know, it's too much. The only way to eliminate it is to go straight from the consecrated hands right to the mouth. But now we've added another element of the mask. And people need, it's just going to be a little confusing. We're going to bumble through that and there's going to be more mistake. And so that is part of the struggle. The people, the Catholics who are strong supporters of receiving only on the tongue will use very strong language like, it is desecration of our Lord if fragments are mishandled and then walked on, trampling. Our Lord is being trampled on in the Mass. That is what you will hear coming from these strong, very vocal supporters of receiving the Eucharist on our tongue. That, I mean, how do you unhear language like desecrating our Lord in Mass? I don't want any part of that. Maybe I should take this more seriously. I don't want to be a part of desecrating our Lord. And yet, it is very, very easy to do if you're not paying attention. And we are so easily distracted. That's kind of a human nature thing. We're easily distracted. And if you can't see it, then you don't know it's there. And so the safest way, it would seem, is just receive on the tongue. And then you don't got to worry about any. It all just goes away. Receive on the tongue, the problems go away. So I, Jennifer Willits, I really, really want this very next reception of our Lord. I want to be kneeling and I want to receive on the tongue. So now I have to wait and see what my chances are because I don't yet know what Father Higgins is going to do. He has that decision to make.
It's all on you, Father.
I will say this.
All responsibility, if it goes so terribly wrong, all on you, Father.
Okay. The memo said
he should totally never have let us know he listens sometimes.
Yeah, I know. The memo from the Archdiocese of Atlanta. Now I'm sure I don't know. It's just a hunch that the language used is not going to be that different between the memo the priest received versus the one that the laity received in terms of how they want priests to distribute our Lord and the Eucharist to the faithful. They're saying we strongly urge you to dispense our Lord and the Eucharist on the hand. They didn't say outright banned.
Here's the exact phrase.
They just said strongly urge.
One-way aisles for Holy Communion are recommended. For the time being, the precious blood will not be offered at Holy Communion, and communicants are strongly urged to receive in the hand.
Okay.
Con-celebrating priests should receive by intinction if there is a single chalice.
Now,
so that's all that's said in the memo.
Right. So that means there's a chance.
What you're saying is there's a chance.
Yes. And I want to stand on that. Now, under normal mass situation, what would be the percentage of communicants in our parish, would you say, even receive kneeling?
Receive kneeling?
Kneeling and on the tongue.
1%.
So I'm thinking, what's the big deal? It's probably the same 1% who wants to receive kneeling on the tongue now.
What about just on the tongue? Well, I would still say
there's more. Oh, that's a bigger percentage.
You think?
Oh, sure.
10%?
Oh, I don't know. I think there's maybe 20 or 30%.
I typically have my eyes closed in deep reverent prayer at that time, so I'm not observing other people in a judgmental way at that time.
deep reverent prayer and taking senses.
La 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 la.
I can't hear you. I don't want to hear you.
Just because I have my fingers in my ears at that moment,
I know you.
All right. So here was one thing that I thought was really interesting. In this about returning to the Mass, it said that a cantor and small number of musicians is preferred. Worship aids are not to be used unless they are single use for that Mass only. This is the next two sentences. Use of well-known music and electronic visuals are encouraged. Well, I wish they had put use of good well-known music, not just well-known music, because there's a lot of well-known music. It's terrible at church.
Hey, everybody knows America the Beautiful. Let's sing that one.
Gather us in the weekend. Yeah, okay. But this last line, congregational singing is discouraged. Discouraged, discouraged, discouraged. For all eternity, congregation. No, that's my addition. But I just thought it was really interesting in a document from the church. congregational singing is discouraged. I was like, wow, I'm highlighting that. I'm going to post the screenshot on Twitter. But also, of course, things like hand-holding during the Our Father, don't do it. Sign of peace, don't do it. Those kinds of things. So, but it's wearing a mask all through Mass. I think some people are really going to struggle.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's going
to
be tough.
I think that some people are going to go to church that shouldn't be going to church. I really appreciated this morning at Daily Mass, our priest saying to people online, we will find a way of getting the Eucharist to you. If you know, the dispensation, by the way, the dispensation still continues through the end of June. So
yeah, June 28th or something like that.
Just because Mass is going to start to be offered again at Daily Mass on May 25th and then on the weekend of the 30th and 31st, that the dispensation still is in place. If you are not healthy, you shouldn't be going. And again, this is Archdiocese of Atlanta. Every diocese is going to be different. But and I think that needs to be repeated time and time again, particularly at a time right now where there's so much division, so many people, there's so much discrepancy. It's like some people are like, well, this isn't really a big thing after all. And other people are like, well, this is a big, still the worst thing to ever happen in the world. And so how do you do that?
Here's what I will say. It won't be...
The thing that I'm going to say is the words that come out of my mouth next.
Really? Do I... When I'm doing a podcast, do I really have to preface anything with that phrase? Here's what I'm going to say.
You can just say it. You can go ahead and just talk, because no one else is going to interrupt you right now.
For those people out there who are very, very germophobe... leaning, inclined to whatever. And there are many. There are many. I would say, dear, dear individual, and you know who you are.
Me.
Listen, for your own sanity and for your own peace of mind, there is one thing that you can focus on that is truly good and verifiable, because I think that person will be very, very tempted to be like a monitor to watch every child, every hand, every individual. You're going to be drawn to look, he touched that. They just hugged. Oh my gosh, they hugged. You know, you don't want to do that to, because you will be driven insane. But you can hang on to the fact that has an improvement occurred? Have steps been taken to minimize the spread of a, contagion, whatever. Yes, that is true. It is going to be more sanitary, even if the church only provides a 10% improvement from previous. It's still a 10% gain of a more sanitized gathering than probably we have ever experienced. It won't be perfect. There will be people hugging. There will be people touching the same things. You just have to know that will happen. Do not be surprised when you see it. It will be the case. People should not be...
not afraid. I'll touch that thing before you. Now you have germs. They all come from me.
Because I think, how would Jesus himself, he does not scorn people. He just loves them. He'll sort it all out later. And we have to have faith that the things that we cannot see are not out to kill us. Have some faith. And that's how I'm going to see it. That's how I am going. I'm going to walk in there fully expecting to see contact happening between people. And all I can say is, okay, everyone is free to choose their comfort level, and they're comfortable. And so I hope that, Greg, when you see this Mass and you see all the contact happening, it is going to be less than what it was before.
Well,
it will be healthier by default.
I have never in my life ever had any desire whatsoever to be an usher.
Until now,
so that I could do exactly what you just said I won't be able to do. I want to be 6 feet, 6 feet.
Oh my gosh.
Six.
You're going to be the hall monitor.
I'm going to go in with a Nerf gun full of Purell and just go. Or squirt gun, not a Nerf gun. And just like a soaker. You know, the super soaker.
You would be crazy good at it.
I'm afraid. Okay. So I will say this. I've shared the story already like five times. I won't say it again about the Knight of Columbus guy who came right up to the car during the day. I have pity on priests who have to be very clear. For example, ushers, priests, tell your ushers when they're distributing the bulletin. I'm not saying this happens at our church, but I'm saying that it does.
Well, now they won't. They can't.
When they're distributing the bulletins, don't lick your thumb to pull off the next bulletin. As maybe someone did. Like, after this all started at our very last Mass that we went to. Don't lick your thumb. Just don't. I mean, it's almost like they need to wear rubber gloves.
Yeah, because then you'll have the grip.
Well, and then they don't want to lick the rubber.
Right.
Or the latex or whatever.
Yeah, they're not going to put that in their mouth.
And so make ushers wear, and I think I said that in the document for Atlanta, that the ushers have to be wearing masks and gloves. And this document even went into detail of how the collection basket's going to go. Just, there are some people that just, you have to think about the other side that is still really afraid right now. And they're taking risks. And I'll put myself in that. I'm concerned about going to Mass. I am still concerned. And I'm not alone in that. So I'm going in, and if I'm going to go in a week and a half from now, I'm good with that. I'm good with us going. Just don't make it harder on everyone else. Just because if you're so lackadaisical about it that you're licking bulletins or you're walking right up to people's cars, stop it. Be aware that there's still people that are tiptoeing back into society. You might have already been in it for a while. There's people that are tiptoeing back in, and it's an anxiety-inducing and stressful thing for them, and they're trying to go out and see Jesus. And they're glad to see you, but be respectful. Just and if we all can do that, we're all going to do great. So that's my little thing. So we did something fun last week that we need to do more of. And part of it is it always falls on me to have to schedule these things and set it up because it's behind the scenes things.
Wait a minute. It always falls on you. I suggested it.
You did, but I still had to send out the emails and set up the YouTube thing and
Do you want me to do any of that?
I would have to teach you how to do it. And that's another thing.
Okay.
Delegation sounds like such a great thing until you have to do the delegation. And then it's like trying to explain it. And then you're just like, I don't know if it happened. Did it happen? No one told me if it happened. Someone just said that they're going to do it. And I don't know if they did it. So at some point, it would be wonderful if you took on these things. I don't know if I could explain it to you. What a great introduction this was. this fun thing that happened last week that apparently now is a stressful thing. We finally did a live stream hangout. Not just a live stream where we're talking and people are sitting there watching, but we have done this a few times and we did it more when we were in Indiana. We've only done it a couple times here in Georgia, where we use Zoom and we send out a meeting invite to all of the people who are our Patreon co-producers. And a lot of times I have a bad habit of, because I never know how I'm going to feel from one day to the next, and I don't know if I'm going to want to hang out. A lot of times I'm like, hey, you know what? I'm in a good mood right now. And we're about to do this thing. Why don't we invite people to participate? And we'll invite our co-producers. And so I'll send out a last minute thing. And a lot of times people, because it's last minute, they didn't get the email. They don't know about it. So we planned this at least a few days in advance. And we kept telling people during our live rosaries, hey, don't forget, we're going to do this on Thursday night. And finally, last Thursday, after our rosary live stream, a few minutes later, we went live with the Zoom call. And we had, I don't know what, like 22 people, I think, showed up to hang out with us on this call. And just what a joy it was to be able to see the faces, hear everyone sharing what's going on in their part of the world. My favorite thing was when someone would say something kind of directed at us, and then another co-producer would like respond to that person. And suddenly, when other co-producers are talking to each other in the call, and we didn't even have to respond. It was like, right, our co-producers were getting to know each other. And that is the epitome of community. When they start to care about each other, and it's not just they're there because of our podcast or whatever. That is that to me. I love that. I love when I start to see community being built because we got emails afterwards from some people saying, "Hey, will you let me know when that person does this thing and that will you share this information or will you send that person a note and let that person know?" And I love that. I love the fact that this idea of our co-producers wanting to communicate with each other like that. I just loved it.
One of the big conversation topics that usually attracts another Patreon co-producer to speak to another Patreon co-producer is when they start saying where they live, where they're from. Whenever community members start mentioning cities and states, you always see a face light up. That's like, oh, I'm from there. I know all about that place. That's what gets them talking to each other is they realize they do, in fact, have things in common. Places of interest, places where maybe former employers or military connections. And that's really fun to watch them sort of joyfully connect on common ground that they didn't even know they had.
Somehow we have a high percentage of librarians who listen to the show, apparently.
Yes.
We had like 3 librarians out of the 22 people that joined us for that live stream. 3 of them were librarians.
So we thought that was an odd but funny kind of a thing to be revealed on that live Zoom cast. So it was great. It was so wonderful to see so many faces. And everyone was so like articulate and calm, and they just, it's like they were so comfortable. That was kind of a cool thing. Everyone was relaxed and just happy to be there, happy to listen to everyone talking, to learn what it's like for people in all their, what they're experiencing, all the different cities across the country. And it was kind of cool to be reminded of, wow, some people have it far worse than I do. Like you get comfortable in your bubble of coronavirus response, you know, like that takes on a certain level of normalcy for you. And then you think everyone is experiencing the same version of normal, but that's not the case. I mean, we were speaking, one woman has been receiving the Eucharist all along and she was the only one out of the 22 people. Just like, I mean, I feel bad that y'all haven't been able to, but I do. And it's been amazing. And
since Palm Sunday, she said.
Yeah, since
Palm Sunday. So she missed it for a few weeks.
And so I was like, wow, it didn't even occur to me that some people have access. And I thought no one had access, you know. And so some people, you know, have already, they've already had a greater lifting of restrictions. And some people had, nope, we're all locked down. We're afraid to leave our house. And so, and everything in between. And so it was a great opportunity, one, to remember other people aren't feeling the same things as you. They are, in fact, feeling very, very different things. And some have far greater levels of sadness to contend with, far greater levels of restriction to contend with and sorrow to contend with. And so ultimately, if you're having an easy time through this, be grateful, be thankful that that is your experience. But do not think that is a universal thing. It isn't. So a lot was learned, and I think it was a great, great meeting.
One of my favorite parts of it was getting the chance to talk to some people who we have talked to in the past and met in real life and that kind of thing and seeing their faces again. It's kind of funny. You know, again, we're on this, looking at the screen on my laptop, which isn't a huge screen in the first place. And on my laptop, then I have every single face showing in this grid so that you see 22 small little windows. And one of them, you know, we're going through and we're saying hello to everyone. And one of them, I just saw a first name. I didn't see the last name. And just, I only saw like the person was using an iPad and only half of her face was showing. And so I couldn't, it wasn't until we were on this call for like an hour and a half before I realized it was my cousin. My cousin Ann was sitting there, and as we're going to her, and it's like, okay, so Ann, I'm like, wait a minute. And I'm like looking at this little, it's like smaller, her face was like smaller than a dime on my computer screen. And I'm like, and it's bad light. And I'm like, is that, it looks like, and I felt kind of silly that I didn't realize that my cousin was there the whole time that we were having this conversation. So sorry, Annie. But seeing so many other people, including one of the greatest things for last week, and to hear him talk about this. A longtime supporter of Rosary Army, the Mast family. They have just been so supportive financially and just emotionally and spiritually for many, many years. And I was telling Lily yesterday, so the Mast family has been supporting Rosary Army since before Lily was born. And you know, so she's like, wow, that's a really long time. I said, it is a really long time. And I'm not even quite sure how Kim found out, Kim's the dad, how he found out about us in the first place. But we met Kim and one of his sons when you and I were invited to speak at the Franciscan University of Steubenville back in 2008. And they were having a media conference, and they like named us two of seven leaders in Catholic New Media that year, that kind of thing. And Kim and his son flew out from Colorado and came and spent the weekend there and went to the different talks and that kind of thing. And that whole weekend was such a blur. But then when we moved to Colorado, I'm there my first week or first month in the office, and this family came in and introduced themselves as the Mast family. I'm like, oh my goodness, so good to meet you. And they were all there because their son, CJ, was meeting with the Archbishop. He had applied and was going through the process of trying to get into seminary. He was discerning the priesthood. Well, Kim was on the call with us last week, and his wife was there too, and sharing with us the excitement and just all the emotional overload going into this. This is on Thursday. That on just 2 days later, on Saturday, his son CJ, who they all came by my office all those years ago, right after we got to Denver back in 2013, CJ was going to be ordained a priest after all these years. And just, you could hear it in Kim's voice, you know, kind of was trembling a little bit as he's talking. He could hardly even say the words, my son's about to be a priest. And he shared the link and for the live stream for the ordination. And we didn't get the chance to watch that, but he also shared a link for his son's first mass as a priest, which was yesterday afternoon. And what was really neat was the priest who would give the homily at his first mass was Father Daniel Chuchi, who, I don't know if we've ever shared the story of Father Daniel, but the weekend after we arrived in Denver, I was already there for a couple months, but right after you guys had arrived, a week after we moved into the house, we had to go to a gala for the seminary. And this is part of my job at the Archdiocese. There were all these, you know, benefits and fundraisers, and they wanted Archdiocesan staff there, and my boss wanted me there. So we went to this gala, and this young pup, this kid, seminarian, comes walking up to us and says, are you Greg and Jennifer Willits? And that was weird. We said, yes. He said, I'm Daniel, and I learned how to make rosaries, you know, from Rosary Army, and I've made a ton of them, and I've given them away. And we're like, uh-huh, yeah, we've heard this story before. He goes, no, seriously. I have a Rosary Army t-shirt back in my room at the seminary. I'm like, wait a minute. You're serious. It's like, you're not just making comments. You're serious. And sure enough, that night, like, he sent me an email with a picture of him wearing this t-shirt. Well, Daniel became friends with our family. He would come over for dinner, come over and make us dinner, made homemade pasta in our kitchen, ended up being our son Walter's confirmation sponsor. And so it was so neat that this weekend, yesterday, we watched this live stream first mass for Father C.J. Mast in the Archdiocese of Denver. And Father Chuchi, Father Daniel, was the one who gave the homily. And man, was it a homily. It was such a good, I sent Father Daniel an email, a text, I hope I sent to the right phone number, because I think it might be an older phone number, so hopefully he got it. He just did such a good job. And he said so many things about, you know, the priesthood that I thought that resonated with me just as a father, just talking about how easy it is to allow criticism, to allow mistakes, to allow the words of others to create a paralysis of fear that would keep you from being the effective father and leader that you're supposed to be.
Yeah, he described in his homily three common types of fear that most priests deal with. But once you hear those three types of fear, you realize, well, I got that too.
Do you remember all three of them?
I remember one was unworthiness. That was the first.
Yep.
Feel the fear of feeling, who am I? I'm not worthy to do this, you know. The second one.
Would the unworthiness, did that tie into like feeling like unqualified, not just unworthy?
Yeah, it's an unqualification. Like, yes, I'll never be able to.
I'll never be good enough to do this job.
Yeah, good enough.
So that's two different things from being unworthy. Unworthy is like, I'm such a sinner that I'm unworthy to do this. So I get that. That's one mindset. The other, and this is what kind of resonated with me, is sort of like, you know, with everything that's been going on with us, and this is why Father Daniel's homily resonated with me during this was, you know, I think about when we went to, well, we'll talk about this maybe on later on, but when we went to Denver, when we moved to Indiana, those jobs, while there was a considerable part of the jobs that I was good at, you know, I have struggled since then with feeling, oh, I completely failed in those jobs because I was so unqualified there. But it wasn't that. And I think that's what he was kind of touching on, those are the kind of lies that we tell ourselves when things don't go our way. We start to look for excuses for why things didn't go our way, and then we start to do a lot of self-blame. And I can see a priest do that a lot, to a point where a priest could easily become ineffective because of those kinds of negative thinkings that can happen.
The second one I'm going to have to look up, but I remember the third one was fear of failure. That I remember very strongly.
I think that ties into that qualifications. Like, well, I'm not qualified. If I try this and if I fail, then it's only going to highlight how unqualified I am.
But his homily, it was captivating. Yeah. And like, wow, what? And it was, not only did he speak to some universal truths of fatherhood, but I loved how he kept tying it in to CJ. And CJ was in kind of his saying yes to God was built into the homily so that it was very kind of customized and special, not just for CJ, but for all fathers who adhered and the importance of the role of fathers to sons. And this homily needs to be shared like every dad. If you're a dad, you need to hear this homily.
And because it was on YouTube, I can share the link so that you can see Father CJ's first mass and you can hear Father Daniel's his homily for this. And so I will definitely add that to the show notes. So if you are watching this right now or listening to this on Overcast or other devices, and you look down in the chapters right now, it should be a link that will take you to that. Or you can go over to gregandjennifer.com/327 and click on the link there to get to the YouTube video if you want to watch that. So it was wonderful. Kim, thank you so much for sharing that story with us and giving us the opportunity to pray for CJ, but just how wonderful it was to be able to share so many other people. And then also because we've been doing the live stream rosary so many nights, last week you surprised me on Thursday night right before this, and I wasn't expecting this. Last Christmas, you know, we finish opening up our presents, and then you tell me, by the way, there's one more present that I got for you, but I don't have all the pieces together, and so I'll give it to you soon. And that was at Christmas. And so what is it now? Today is May 18th as we're recording this. Right. So that means December, January, February, March, April, May. 5 months I've been waiting for whatever this secret Christmas present is. And you know, the fact that you told me that, I'm just assuming in the week or two after Christmas, this would happen. And then months and months go by.
And then coronavirus.
And then we're sitting there praying the live rosary on Thursday night. And we're wrapping it up. And we're saying goodbye. And we're getting ready to do this live Zoom hangout thing. And then you pulled a switcheroo on me.
Right. Well, there's just one thing I wanted to sort of explain, that there was no time or opportunity to really tell you this before I presented you the gift. But the context is to me pretty important here, because I had this idea of wanting to make you something special and what I believed would be significant to you in particular. And so I started thinking, what could I do that would be kind of tailored and customized for Greg? Because, you know, I mean, like last week or maybe 2 weeks ago when we did the birthday quarantine birthdays, I did talk about how one of the difficulties is you want to give a gift that you hope will be well received by the recipient. And so you try to think about it, but you don't want to give a gift that you think, oh, well, I would like this, so that's why I'm going to make this gift, is because I want it, you know? And I know Greg, one of Greg's love languages is receiving gifts. And I know that sounds kind of funny. It's like, well, of course, who wouldn't? Who wouldn't love to receive a gift? But it's receiving not just any gift, but a gift that shows you know me. You know who I am. Thank you for seeing me. Thank you for acknowledging me. So last year, probably October, November, I was already thinking, what can I do? What can I do? And I thought, all right, here's what I would like to do. I wanted to involve the very first rosary because it just saddened me that the very first rosary that you ever made that launched this ministry is just in a box, in a little baggie, and that's it.
Was that
no one to see.
Was that in my little wooden box? Did you take it out of that? Where was it?
It was always kept with the archive of Rosary Army, like newspaper clippings. Okay. It's always been kind of grouped with those things that kind of document the early years of Rosary Army's formation. It was just kind of in there. And I thought, okay, I wanted to involve that, and I want to have it on display because that's something of actually significant value. It's like, you know, how we reacted when we took a paint chip off of the Clawfus, when we were repainting the Clawfus, when the Clawfus was this brand new idea of a place for a podcast. It was like this cool thing. And it meant something to us, you know. Anybody looking at a rosary might not think it's a big deal, but this is the rosary that launched it all, you know, that was part of it, part of the, and look at where Rosary Army is today. So I thought, you know what, that's actually important. It needs to be preserved, displayed, something nice. But a rosary in a box, it's not a very, like, wow, like, I don't know what to think about it. Just a rosary in a box. So I felt like it needed an explanation. Like, if you go to a museum and you see an artifact on display, you're looking for the explanation placard. You're like, okay, what's the significance of the thing of which I'm looking at? Oh, in the year 19 so-and-so, the so-and-so, you know, you want a little story. And then you look at the image again, you're like, oh, wow, I have more appreciation for that. So I thought, okay, this is going to be a writing challenge. Okay, I can do it. I can do it. I mean, I'm an author. I've written. How hard can this be? So I started looking. Now, of course, my memory is not as powerful as Greg's. Greg can remember dates.
Well,
he can remember weather patterns, movies that were out of the time, clothing fashions of when statements were made in the news. I mean, Greg's brain is like crazy with remembering everything surrounding a moment. And he can pull that into any writing piece of literature that he does.
And that superpower has lessened in recent years.
Okay.
However, but I appreciate you saying that, but it's lessened.
Okay. So I thought, I want to write down some kind of statement that goes next to the rosary. And so I had already begun writing this thing, and I thought, well, let me look at the newspaper clippings and to refresh my memory of the beginning of the facts and the history of Rosary Army. Like, how, what is it? Where, what was the year? What was the date? When I remember bits and pieces, but it's cloudy over time. And so here we are, the week of Christmas. And, you know, Sam was visiting us for Christmas, and he's a creative writer. And so I actually said, Sam, help me out here. Christmas is like an hour's away. It's only like, I don't know how to, this is what I have. And so we had all these discussions about, do we want to be literal or do we want to be abstract? Is there a way to write this in a poem? I wanted to write it in a poem. I didn't want to use names and dates because then it sounds too much like a journalism article in a newspaper. And that's not very special and loving. And it's just going to be nothing new. And he's already read this stuff. And I wanted to be something new. And so he said, you know, Sam gave me advice, writing advice of, you probably want to stay more abstract and then let the reader pull and make the inference. And I'm like, yeah, that's what I want to do, but this is going to take me more time. My brain is too shattered right now. I don't have what I need in my mental resources to write what I want to write. Okay. The other thing I want you to consider is the timing. Right now, Greg, you are very comfortable in your role of being sort of involved with Rosary Army, because it's been your world these last few months, Rosary Army. You're making t-shirts again, you're working on the website. So you have already, in a way, returned to Rosary Army. But that wasn't the case in October of last year. And so I was building this gift with the current reality in mind, of there was not yet this embrace, the embracing of Greg and Rosary Army did not yet occur. And so the gift was meant to sort of be given at a time where you weren't like, it wasn't the number one priority of work to do on your work agenda of tasks that you spent hours on during your work week. And not that you ever left Rosie Army. It was always at least, it shifted. Its priority has been shifting over the years. But as recently as October of last year, it wasn't yet the priority. And so the gift was meant to be given at a time when Rosie Army was still working its way up in the priority list to you. But ironically, things have changed. Despite my giving you the gift and in its lateness, the environment is now completely different. And so I knew my gift, when I finally would get around to giving it to you, would be in a very different world than it was originally intended to give. And so you might think my idea of a Rosie Army gift is not as original for good reason, because our world is very much Rosie Army right now. But last year, it wasn't. It just wasn't. And so I thought the gift could maybe have a little more significance, or maybe be a little more special. I don't know. But I thought I definitely have to write a poem. I mean, that part was true. I knew I had to write the genesis of Rosary Army in poetic form. And if I had not been homeschooling Lily poetry sessions, there's just no way I could have pulled it off. I didn't realize poetic structure. I don't read poetry for my own personal recreation. And so I had to relearn the rules of poetry. And I was, quite naturally, through the homeschool program that Lily was on. And so I thought, okay, I understand the rules.
See, if you ever write a bad poem, here's the biggest rule that I can give to aspiring poets. If you ever write a bad poem and it doesn't have the right pentameter, it doesn't have the right type of cadence to it. Certain lines don't rhyme. Things are out of whack. Just say, oh, no. It was intentional because I was inspired by E.E. Cummings. And that's all you have to say. I was inspired by the works of E.E. Cummings.
Okay.
And that erases, you basically can't argue with that because he did whatever he wanted.
Sure.
And he just threw words scattershot onto a page in random order. Like one word would be up in the right-hand corner. The other would be dead center. The other one would be on the back of the page. It's a poem. Right. It's E.E. Cummings. That's all you have to say. And then I guess it's good.
Right. There's no such thing as a bad poem. But it was such a literary challenge that I knew that I was going to need prayer to help get me through it, because of the rules of the game that I put into place. I knew I wanted this moment, this poem, to capture a moment in time that occurred. I wanted to capture just one thing. You going to confession and seeing that knotted rosary on the lap or the hand of the priest. And that was the moment I was trying to capture. You going to confession, seeing that rosary, receiving the sacrament of, forgiveness, and then how that thought came back to you and it drove you to creating the first one. And then here we are today. And so, because when you write anything, you have to decide, well, what is it that you want to say? What's the moment you're trying to capture in words, and then do that thing? And so then I wanted it to rhyme. I wanted it to be a little abstract, but I just wanted it to clearly be about you and what you went through and your experience, but also be very Catholic. And I wanted, so every sentence was labored over. There was nothing written in just a few minutes and then done. There must be about 100 different versions of that was the final one. And I just put myself through a lot of kind of emotional stuff to build this thing that I hoped would be well received. I mean, because I really don't know what you're going to think of it, or if anything, And so I feel like, well, maybe presenting him this gift, because I finally got the poem down, and I put it in a shadow box, and I bought this paper like 6 months ago to make it look a little bit more old. It's like a parchment paper, and it had to be for laser printers. I had to find that, but I wanted it to look kind of old but new, and all this. And so then I finally put it all together, and then I wrapped it up in Christmas paper because it was, in fact, a belated Christmas gift. And I decided to give it to him during the last Rosary live stream broadcast. So if you were there that day, I mean, you could still see it. It's on YouTube.
I can put a link to that as well.
You know, I decided to surprise Greg with it. And let me tell you, Greg, the entire time we were praying that rosary, my heart was like, ka-dink, 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 because I knew what I was going to do. And my plan was always to go, wait, 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 Greg, don't turn off the camera. There's something I want to do. And so I think it was a little bit like how you felt when for Mother's Day, and you kept looking at your phone, and you knew what you were going to do. You knew the surprise you were going to reveal to me, and you were understandably a little anxious and nervous, but for all the good reasons, because you were going to give me something that only you knew about, and you've known about it for a while, and then you hope that the gift is well received, you know. And so I went through the exact same thing during the rosary, unbeknownst to you, because I just wanted to give that to you. So
did you want to read the poem?
Sure. Yeah, I can do it. It's right there.
So
in a lovely case.
And when I walked into the office area here, and I didn't know you put it there. I was like, oh, well, there it goes.
Well, I don't know.
No, I'm saying that made sense for it. Okay. Like, it was like, well, that make yeah, there. That's where it belongs, right there. It's like, I'll just, good. I don't have to think about it. you propped it up. It's like, all right, there, okay. I'm done.
Okay. So right now, the title of the poem is called The Knotted Rope. Because, like, yeah, I can't just call a rosary. He's like, yeah, gotta be abstract, you know. Here we go. A mother's desire from her heavenly station is how it all began. A man, a priest, and reconciliation put into place her plan. The man would feel the undoubtable notion it was time to be freed from the chains of sin and the conflict within, halting the sprout from its seed. The priest would sit in his cell of forgiveness, waiting for contrition to arrive. With a knotted rope of perpetual hope, his mother's love fully alive. Alas, the man stood before confession's door, the lost sheep having found his way. But even the priest could not foresee how the man's purpose would change that day. All it took was one single look, the rope implanted in the man's mind, but first had to free the offenses committed, so forgiveness he would find. For the mother's plan to come to fruition, the seed would need its water. This son would recall the image in confession, the weapon of the father's daughter. Fully engaged, this son would not rest until the pattern of knots was found. Then the first was created, and he knew without doubt this holy rope would gain ground. The plan was now ready, the materials acquired, for there was much recruiting to do. For this knotted rope would lead to another, and would birth an army anew.
Thank you, baby. It's very nice. Now, what's weird is, again, and I'll post a picture of this too. So if you're looking right now on your podcast app, look down at the picture for this chapter, and you'll see this original rosary that I made. And I just don't know if a picture could ever do it justice, but it was made with macrame cord. It's just, to me, it's just a scary looking rosary, but it makes. It's important.
Yeah, it's important because it is the first, and
it's 17 years old.
It really shows how things sometimes look imperfect. They look bumpy, rugged, but they still have a lot of heart, a lot of meaning. And it just makes me think of, like, when a carpenter makes something, it has all these little, can be rough and little imperfections, but that's part of its charm. It's part of its beauty. And, but to me, I mean, my gift was really the poem, you know. I don't know how, cause that's the only thing I could make. Well, I didn't make the rosary, but no, I can make the poem.
But if you hadn't held on to it and put it away, I mean, I tend to, you know, I think some people are kind of surprised. Like years ago, we got rid of, you know, one time when we were going to move, we got rid of all these boxes of writings and letters and things that I had kept for years. And at some point, I just kind of quit holding on to mementos and things like that. Like, we don't have a lot of things from, you know, the kids' first grade or kindergarten and that kind of thing. And I would have lost track of that rosary at some point. I didn't even realize that you had it, you know. And it is important. And
like, don't forget your roots.
Well, yeah. And I tend to...
It was a life-changing moment
despite
for you.
Despite the fact that you... that. So here's a such a weird... I don't know what... This is a contradiction in myself. You talked about how I remember dates and events and all those kinds of things. And I do, yet I tend not to... I tend not to want to hold on to some of the good stuff. And so it's almost like there's a fear of holding on to the good stuff too tightly that I tend to let it go too quickly. And so things like that first rosary, even though I have the memory of it, and I remember when I first started doing it, there's something about the early days of it. It's like I'd much rather think about where we are now rather than where we were 17 years ago with the beginning of Rosary Army. And that's not necessarily a good thing. I'm not justifying it. I'm just saying that's what I tend to do. So the fact that you did hold on to that, the fact that you did put it in a box, now it won't go away. Whereas if it was left up to me, it probably would. Not because I want it to. It's just that's what I tend to do, right or wrong. And so I think, while the poem is beautiful and I appreciate the hard work that you put into it, I do appreciate the fact that you put the rosary in a shadow box and then you pinned it there and it's held there and it's there, because that now that's something that's going to be doubly valuable, hopefully, to one of our children when we're gone, that they're going to be able to say, that's the first rosary Dad ever made. And that's a poem that Mom wrote about it. And you know, that theoretically you just made a family heirloom, and that's special. So thank you for that. All right, so we get a lot of email and don't always have a chance to respond to all of it, but got an email a couple weeks ago that I did want to respond to, but not necessarily respond to it by responding, but rather pointing the person to something else, right? But rather than us giving an answer, so here's the email, and this was from Mark. He says, Greg, why is the church silent? I can't stand this destruction of our faith. Let me say he also included an article that sort of talked about a lot of bad things happening within the organizational structure of the church. He says, the Pope is the alpha wolf and the bishops are hirelings. That was a quote from the article. If it wasn't for your podcast, I would be having a much harder time. I will be stronger and more faithful, but I am disgusted with Rome. Reminds me of the popes that that were immoral thousands of years ago. He says, he's in New Mexico and our parish is going against the bishop of our church. We pull up in a car after Sunday Mass, Facebook Live, and get communion. Tears every time. All right, so a few different things in here. Thank you for the email. Thank you for asking us and reaching out. So I understand being frustrated with leadership. And we're going to talk a little bit about this here in a minute for another email that we got. We have worked for and with different dioceses and the ecclesiastical organizations. And as we were talking about, I sort of understand the chancery language of things. And I don't like it, but I can understand it. Like I can comprehend it. I don't necessarily agree. Understanding does not necessarily mean agreement, but I see what is happening. And so, you know, there are so many, I will say this lately. I have friends who I would say are longtime friends that are very, very well known in the Catholic online sphere. And we've had these people on our shows in the past, but I greatly care about these people, but I in recent months have followed less and less online, even to the point where some months, like on Facebook, I'll go, you know what? I'm going to click the little button and I'm going to say, mute that person for 30 days. Because it's very easy, especially when we are sequestered the way we've been, for certain news to get more energized, more than it should, and some opinions more energized, more than it should. And I get people forwarding emails to me all the time from various Catholic conspiracy theorists. And it's very rare when those types of emails do anything but stir up unrest in me. So my first recommendation is it frustrating right now at times to be a Catholic? Yes. Because of the leadership? Yes. Is it frustrating when we don't see bishops, priests, or pope preaching about the things that we think that they should be? Yes, absolutely. We spoke about this once when we were still, I think, in Colorado. It was in Indiana, because it was when the whole Archbishop Vigano thing came out back in August of 18, I think. And he pointed out a lot of things that leadership in Rome did not do when they should have in regards to former Cardinal McCarrick. And that was a very frustrating thing. It's like, well, why didn't they do this? And why didn't they say something? And what did they know? And when did they know it? And, and again, there's all these conspiracy theories that are going on. It's very easy to get frustrated and disgusted with quote-unquote Rome, or with the chancery, or with the diocese. I have heard priests about their own dioceses say that there's a cancer in this diocese. There's a cancer in the chancery. There's a cancer in the archbishop's office. I'm not talking about Atlanta. I'm talking just in general. I've heard priests say that about their dioceses wherever they are. And I will just say, again, having worked for archdioceses and with, knowing so many other priests in other dioceses, there is no perfect diocese, because people run these things. And therefore, it does get political. It does, people make bad mistakes. People make wrong decisions. And when we allow ourselves to get frustrated, all we're allowing is for ourselves to get frustrated. Our frustration will do nothing. Our frustration doesn't solve anything. So that's kind of what I say, that from one who does get frustrated. Why don't they say more about this? Why don't we hear, why doesn't the bishop write a letter to the faithful about the Eucharist and say, this, we are a Eucharistic people, this is going to be our focus. Why doesn't the bishop write a letter to the faithful about holy matrimony and say, we are a church that believes in holy matrimony because family, one man and one woman and the children that come from that relationship are the foundation of society, and it's, why don't they do that? And then they don't do it, and I could just get frustrated that they don't do that. Or I can continue to pray for them and trust that they are doing what they can do in whatever sphere of influence that they do have. So I get it. It's very, very frustrating when you are frustrated.
Mark, I have a YouTube video that I think will make you feel comforted in light of the frustration that you shared with us in your email about, the language that you use is actually very strong language, the destruction of our faith. Now, I will go ahead and tell you, I feel like your language is overly harsh, because our faith isn't being destroyed.
But let me say, I understand why he said that, because of all of the emails and websites and some of the Catholic influencers that are using words like that. There are Catholic organizations that use, our church is being destroyed from within. The church is being damaged. Those are the words that are being shared.
Right. It won't be destroyed. It can take damage.
Yeah.
I would say, but absolutely.
But again, those are the things that I stopped following. I will oftentimes stop following, even if they're people that I know personally and care about. I don't need that kind of dust in my brain right now.
Right.
Clogging the works.
Now, I have a YouTube video I want you to watch, Mark, that I truly believe will give you a very intelligent and comforting way of how to feel when you see members of the church behaving in a certain way, which is a very, very legitimate request. I think everybody has a right to know, well, how should I be feeling right now? Well, we want to turn to the church for guidance in such matters. And so I just happened to click on this YouTube link from the John Henry Weston show, who is he's in charge of LifeSite News, and he has...
And let me throw out there, right? Because I already know some people bristle.
Sure, of course.
LifeSite News is one of the websites. I, I like it, but I also take it with a grain of salt because they can sometimes come off as
a little sensational.
A little sensational. Right. Okay. So understand that going into it. Take that with a filter, right? Just like a lot of websites, our podcast, take it with a filter. What's their perspective? Where are they coming from? What's their experience? Take that filter, hear what's being said, and then discern it as you can understand it and take it to prayer.
So there is this one episode in particular, and we'll put a link in the show notes, where John Henry interviewed Catholic convert Steve Ray. And it was very recently done, like 7 or 8 days ago. But in that, Steve Ray gives probably one of the best explanations I have ever heard about a great many things, one of which being the Catholic Church as a whole. Also, the response toward bishops during the coronavirus in particular, including Pope Francis himself, but it was such a beautiful, diplomatic, but strongly worded sort of an explanation that I think it will resonate with you. So I'm not going to summarize what Steve Ray said so eloquently and powerfully on that particular interview. I highly recommend you watch it so that it can help you regain perspective once again, to help restore hope in you right now. Because I hear your frustration in the language that you use in your email. So my response to you is I want to help restore hope back in you, because that's really what all Christians should be a part of, is restoring hope in one another.
So talking about restoring hope, one thing I have very little hope in is Christian media in general. Now that's shocking, because here we are, we're doing a Christian podcast.
We are a part of the media.
We are a part of the media. But what I mean is, for many years, there have been this slew of Christian-produced movies, things like Fireproof and all sorts of other movies. I can't even remember the names of them now. God Is Not Dead, movies like that, that you know what the plot line is going to be. That there's going to be someone who is pushing against God, doesn't like the idea, or having a rough time in life. Someone that they know comes to Jesus, wants their loved one to come to Jesus. The person keeps pushing back. Finally, they come to such a hard time in their life that they have no choice. And out of desperation, they call out to God. God fixes everything. And then suddenly they're in a Bible study and the movie ends. And so many well-intentioned people have made media that is so hard to watch. And I have not been able to sit through a quote-unquote Christian production of a movie or television show in years, because it reeks of cheese. It just is so cheesy and feels like it's 20 years behind a lot of the content that is so professionally made. So I tend to avoid that entirely. Now, you're a little bit more forgiving than I am. And I know that you've watched certain movies and TV shows with Lily. Maybe we'll watch something with you when it comes out, and your curiosity is oftentimes raised up. But like, there's a movie coming out about Fatima. I immediately go,
And I totally want to see
I'm curious about the Fatima one. I've heard decent things about it from people that I trust. But in the past, there have been a lot of movies that have come out, and everyone's like, oh, you have to go see this movie. You need to see this movie. You have to see this movie. And we've gone, and it was like, and then afterwards, we're asked, hey, will you give a quote about it? I'm like, I don't want to. There's a movie, and I won't say what it was, that came out when we were still on radio, and we were asked, please go see this movie. And we went to a premiere of it. And when we came out, they actually had cameras set up, and we gave a testimony. And I mean, it's like they caught us right when we're coming out. And, you know, so we said what our first impression was, like the credits were still rolling inside. And then we got in the truck and we're driving home. And as we're driving home, we go, well, wait a minute, what about, hey, you know, and that part bothered me. And that wasn't quite. And by the time I woke up the next morning, I no longer liked the movie. And you've done this, right? Where you go see a movie and then you talk about it. And the more you think about it, it's like, well, that, you know what? They took a lot of shortcuts. You start to see that it starts to fall apart a little bit. Well, they had filmed us, videotaped us. And this was still when we were on Sirius XM. So our words, I think, meant a little bit more at one point than they do now. But we walked out and then they started sending us emails saying, oh, we forgot to have you sign a release form. Will you sign this release form so that we can use that video in publicity? And I just kind of kept ignoring the emails. I just was like, no, you just provided me a loophole. And so that's kind of how I'm always kind of on guard for these kinds of things. So I've started to see, and you probably have seen this as well, a lot of people online talking about this TV show called The Chosen, which is, it's a TV series about the life of Jesus Christ. And
when he was choosing the original 12, it's that moment really.
And so, you know, I had seen some clips and it was like a Kickstarter fundraised movie. You know, it was like more money ever raised for an independent production than ever before, for a religious based independent production. And, you know, again, I'm like, I have no interest in this because it's going to be more Christian sub Hollywood subculture cheese is what I just assumed it was going to be. There have been a lot of Jesus movies that have come out and they're either slightly blasphemous, you know, a little insulting. Like there was a movie that came out, I don't know if you even knew this. Did you know that Joaquin Phoenix played Jesus just like in the last 5 years in a movie?
No.
And Rooney Mara, I don't know if you remember her. She was the girl that she was in the
Facebook movie.
Yeah. She played Mary, his mom. And so anyway, I don't know how that worked out. But you know, that movie. And then a few years ago, there's been a whole bunch, you know, there's been a whole slew of these. It's like, oh, that's going to be really good. And then you go see it. It's like, you know, there's just a lot of liberties. And so then you have to go into these movies. If they're produced by Hollywood, you're like, okay, well, now I have to put on my filter of like, what's Hollywood going to try to turn this into?
Is it going to mock my faith?
You're right.
Because I really care about this story now, so you better be careful with the story.
And then if it's just like sort of some fundraised thing by non-professional filmmakers, then it sometimes has that cheese factor.
Right, because the actors are not going to be well-trained, and sometimes that just shows despite their best efforts.
For example, there was a sitcom called Mass Confusion that was like non-trained actors, non-trained writers, and if you ever saw it, you just know the thing is about the most cheesy Catholic sitcom that there ever could possibly have been. So we know where we're coming from, okay?
We are a part of the
cheese. We are a part of the problem. All right?
No, we're a part of the cheese.
We're part of the cheese. We're the hard, crusty side that started to go moldy. That's us right there. So the thing that started to turn my mind around, though, is that a few people online who I have a good amount of respect for started kind of posting things about The Chosen, and Hector Molina, who's a Catholic evangelist. Hector started posting stuff and goes, this is really good. He goes, as a matter of fact, I'm going to start doing like a Facebook live study about this show. We're going to go episode by episode. And I didn't watch it because I didn't watch Hector's thing because I hadn't seen the show. But I might go back and look at it. But Hector was, you know, spending a lot of time talking about this show. It's like, it's really good. And so I saw like one clip from the first episode and went, okay, that wasn't bad. And sometimes when, as soon as Jesus comes on the screen, except for Jim Caviezel, right? Passion of the Christ was such a perfect example of a non-cheesy movie. However, it only showed the Passion of Christ. It showed small snippets of the joy of Jesus. Like when he's making the table and he and his mom are kind of joking around about that. And he washes his hands and kind of flicks some of the water on his mom. That you see the joy in Jesus there and his relationship with his mom. It's a beautiful scene in Passion of the Christ. But those are so short-lived compared to everything else. So in the back of my mind, I'm thinking we should try watching The Chosen. Well, Jennifer and I have been having alternating bouts of insomnia in recent weeks, where one or the both of us will wake up at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning, can't get back to sleep, climb out of bed, go out, sit in the living room. I mean, it's at least once a week I spend 4 hours in the middle of the night sitting on the living room couch just, you know, looking at junk because I can't sleep. I didn't know that you had so much, or so many of those moments that you had actually watched like 5 episodes of The Chosen in the middle of the night. You didn't even say anything to me about it until this past weekend. And you said, you know, you brought it up and I went, yeah, I'm actually open to watching it. So, well, you grabbed that line as soon as, you know, you realized that the hook was starting to sink. So let's watch one right now. And so we started watching some with Lily. And I will tell you, we've been watching it on YouTube. They did a live viewing party thing. So what's on YouTube right now of The Chosen is the director, creator of the show hosted this live stream of it. So he's at the beginning of it and at the end of it. So he's like in his home library and he's talking, and then they show the whole episode And then he comes on at the end of it and he says something, you know, wrapping it up. So you can fast forward through that part, just jump to each one of these. Or it's produced through a service called VidAngel, which I kind of thought went out of business, but maybe it's something else now. And you can sign up for the VidAngel app, and I believe it's free, and you can watch these episodes for free. That's what I read in one place. I don't know if it's still the case now. And then if you have Chromecast or whatever, you can stream it from your mobile device onto your television. So we have been doing that. We've been streaming it through Chromecast to the TV. And you rewatched all the episodes, or all five of the first episodes this weekend, because I watched them.
Some of the episodes I've seen three times.
And you watched the Wedding Feast of Cana one. No. You watched the one before Wedding Feast of Cana, because Lily didn't see one episode. So you went and watched it. You watched it by yourself, then you watched it with me, and then you went and watched one episode with Lily. So she's caught up. And so the three of us have been watching it. And it has been, I will say, not only has it been well produced, and the acting is genuinely good. I'm really surprised by the actors. I'm genuinely surprised by the writing has been good. And what I really like is the fact that it has genuinely given me food for thought. I think it might surprise you. Can you guess which episode? So in the first five, can you guess which episode sort of resonated with me the most so far?
Well, I guess I will think the Wedding Feast of Cana, because that's one of your favorite mysteries.
It is. So the way that they tell the story is, while it's, they have to, they have written into the scriptures, they've written into it a storyline that isn't necessarily in the Bible.
Right.
They basically are trying to flesh out what was happening in between the verses in the Bible. And that, I think, they've done very well. For example, exactly. You know, we know in Scripture that when Simon Peter meets Jesus for the first time, Jesus tells him to put his nets back out, even though Simon's been fishing all night long, put him back out. And he goes, you know, I've been fishing all night long, I haven't caught anything, so just do this. And then he hauls in a ton of fish. They did a really interesting take of why was he out fishing all night long, and the panic that he was in, and then they
showed you the stakes.
But they even tied in the panic he was in. They tied it into another one of the apostles who was responsible for, basically before he became an apostle, was basically someone that was causing hardship in Simon's life. Well, that wasn't in Scripture. You don't know that's the case, that there was a certain level of adversity between these two before, you know, that they had met before. We don't know if they knew each other before, but they worked that into the story, and it worked because it helps to show the stakes when Jesus did act, as we do see in Scripture. It helped to give life to it, and I'm being intentionally vague so that you can see this for yourself. And they did that for a few different characters. So, for example, they work in one of the apostles into the Wedding Feast of Cana in a different type of a storyline that you never would. It's not in Scripture, but it makes sense in the context of all this, right? So, I've been pleased with the series, but the episode that got me the most was actually the first one, and it was where in the first one they actually have, and Nicodemus, who from Scripture has
I love his storyline.
He has a significant role in this.
Yeah.
And we know that Nicodemus, you know, he did come to Jesus initially at night, and he came to him in darkness and undercover. And well, how did he get to him in the first place? And they're telling kind of a thread of Nicodemus' story. Well, what was really interesting was Nicodemus, before Jesus, trying to cast out demons from what limited knowledge that he had at the time. And that's not something that you ever think about, the idea of casting out demons before Jesus, that was something that perhaps Jewish leaders were trying to do. And the prayers that he said over someone who had demons, multiple demons, the way that the person with multiple demons was then completely healed by Jesus, and Jesus called her by name.
Oh, man. I get chills just that moment. But, is so good.
But as someone who has, I struggle sometimes with how I talk about my own mental health issues. And we've shared a tremendous amount with you in the last 2 years in particular. there's a lot of spiritual warfare that I have gone through for a good part of my adult life. And there's a lot of demonic attack that I believe that I fight not very well. And it is a great source of my anxiety and depression in my life. And there have been many battles in the middle of the night that I've never talked about that are true battles, that are you know, tear-inducing battles that have wreaked havoc in my life. And there was something about that moment of Jesus coming to her and the fact that he can remove these issues completely. And so since watching that just a few days ago, I've also found myself asking, how completely have I, you know, what have I held back? What have I held on to that I have not completely given to Jesus? Intentionally or not. You know, I think a lot of times, and that's the nefariousness of the devil, is he makes it so that he allows you to think that you're making progress, but at the same time, he's holding you back in some areas. And so it just made me stop and think, how much have I allowed Jesus to fully come into my life? Do I fully believe that he can heal me of the ailments that I have? Even after all these years, I mean, I'm going to turn 50 this year, and I've been battling, you know, anxiety and depression in one form or another since to the best of my recollection, since I was 12 was when I first had my first moments that I can remember, right?
When your dad freaked you out in the middle of the...
Yeah.
See that? Ah.
No, it was a different moment. When I was 12.
Yeah.
But you know, I could tie things back to...
That was a tough year struggle. For Greg Willits.
And that episode spoke to me. I find it really interesting... Oh, I've been nervous a couple times, in like the last episode, the Wedding Feast of Cana. I don't like how Mary Magdalene looks at Jesus sometimes, and I don't know if I'm being overly sensitive to it. I don't want them to sexualize it.
Right, but how is a woman supposed to look with admiration at another man?
I know.
It'd be platonic.
But again,
it's also deep love. You know.
So yeah. But it's also me being. Jaded because of past Christian media as well. It's like, well, are they gonna screw this up? So anyway, I that first episode I thought was
it really spoke to you.
Well, it gave me a lot to think about. It has made me question myself, and that's hard to come by with dramatized Christian media. That a dramatized thing, the Passion of the Christ, definitely.
Yeah.
I can't really tell you any others that have made me go, yeah, that really had a significant impact on my spirituality. That it made me question my relationship with Christ. It made me, you know, there's...
Well, there are very few productions that do that. But
yeah, that's what
for
I'm saying.
You, yeah,
that's
but
what I'm
for
saying.
Some people, you know, they...
I know. But like, there's a lot that I just like, I just... Ugh. But this is really... So anyway, this is really well done. This is worth watching. It's worth checking out. I wish that our boys would watch it, but I think that they have their cheese sensor on, and they see, oh, it's about Jesus, so I'm not going to watch it. I think that they already have that, but it makes a lot of sense. It helps, you know. I could see someone watching this and say, okay, now let's look at this in Scripture. I wonder. I would think that they would have made a chosen Bible study already. And again, it's Protestant produced, so I don't. You know, you'd have to take some of it with a grain of salt because, for example, they're doing it. As seasons, it's not like it's wrapped up. They didn't end it with they're not going to end this first season with the crucifixion. At least I don't think they will, unless they do a lot of flashbacks, but I don't think they will. But they're taking it as this is the story of the ministry of Jesus. But
and they're giving it room to breathe.
Yeah, so I don't think they're going to
really
do the,
like.
They're not going to do the Eucharist anytime soon, but if they do, that's going to be the episode where I'm going to go, okay, let's see how they handle this, you know?
Right.
Let's see how they handle John chapter 6. But it's worth watching. It's called The Chosen. I'll put a link to at least the first episode in the show notes if you want to go check it out on YouTube. And it's surprisingly well done. All right, so we got an interesting email. And because of the length of the show, we are not going to answer it this week. But I'd be really curious to have audience participation on answering this. So here's the email. It was from Andrew, who said, Greg and Jennifer, I followed you in the early days and was part of Rosary Army up until the time, roughly, where Greg started with the radio show. I fell away from the church for a number of years for many issues I won't go into now, but after reading the book by coincidence that Jennifer mentioned, which was Your Thoughts Are Killing You, which we actually interviewed the author of that earlier this year, he says, I am fully back and on fire for my faith, reconciliation, and mass. And here's the crux of the email. I therefore have a lot of blanks in my life about your story. You now do not do the radio show, and you have made several moves across the states, but I do not know why. Is there any chance of doing a show to bring us up to date, what happened, why you stopped, moved, etc., or do you have a show number I could listen to that will cover this? And first off, that email, thank you for sending it. It got my mind going in a million different directions.
And thanks be to God that you are fully on fire with the faith.
Oh, yeah, that too.
I knew you were going to glance over that, but that was like, wait, let's take a beat for a second, Greg, and acknowledge this is a sheep who has come back into the fold of the flock.
Yeah. Right.
We should be rejoicing.
Okay, so one thing I will say, is there a single episode that explains everything? I don't think so, but just this, it was providential because it's all, right when you sent this email, over the weekend, you know how Facebook will say, it will pop up memories and say, you know, past memories and that kind of thing. I've gotten, over the last couple of days, I've gotten a lot of Facebook memories from 2 years ago, because 2 years ago is when I left, I resigned from my last full-time job working for a Catholic publisher. And it ended very, very badly, as I've shared multiple times. And one of the things that showed up was, here was this podcast that you did 2 years ago called Jumping Off Another Cliff. So if you go to gregandjennifer.com/226, and I think we started talking about halfway through the episode, where we talked about what happened that caused me basically to be forced to resign from that job. And it was interesting because I went back and I listened to a little bit of it, and I was like, boy, we were so ginger and careful in how we said things. And
every word was walking on an eggshell.
Oh, my goodness gracious. We were tiptoeing left and right. And I thought, you know, 2 years have passed now. And by the way, there were certain things that I had signed when I was still employed as a senior leader at that company that basically said, for 2 years, I won't say, do, you know, anything. Like, I couldn't hire anyone who used to work for me for 2 years. Well, 2 years has now passed. And so there's a little bit more freedom. And I sat there and go, and then we got this email and I went, oh, I could talk about that a little bit more, but there's so much more than that. And really then the story, when I mentioned this to you, it's like, well, how far back do you want to go? And then I thought, well, just kind of I think it's worthwhile on the podcast, at least every few years, to reshare our witness. How is it that we got to this place and how is God working in our lives? And so I don't want to go into the whole thing of how we met and all that in great detail, but I think that it would be worth having a discussion of our story. Now, one thing I thought about doing on our live group last week when we did our live stream chat was I almost was going to ask them, it's like, okay, you tell us the story. You've heard us tell the story, right, of what happened. So you tell us the story. What happened in Denver? And let our listeners, I would be curious to hear, how would you tell the story of what has happened to us? How would you tell the story of the history of Rosary Army in the last 17 years? How would you tell our life story? Because you've heard bits and pieces of it. And a lot of people last week said, I'm one of those people who has heard every podcast episode that you've ever recorded.
So the great thing is, if you retell the story, you're going to be naturally high level, bullet point friendly. If we try to retell the story, we're going to go down every rabbit trail and do far too much exposition and not be able to go back. It's too big of a story.
Well,
I like how they would be abbreviated. That's all I want.
So if you want to try to, I almost wish we could sign up for like create a little form and say, okay,
a Google Doc,
like a Google Doc of like, who's going to tell this part of the story and who's going to tell this part of the story. And we just have to let you tell it. You know, I would be very curious if you want to take a stab. Just choose a random time. And
how about we assign a few people? We know.
No. I mean, hey, send us an email. Go. Okay. I don't know. I don't know how to do this. So maybe you have an idea. Maybe you want to take the reins of communicating with other people and make this happen in the next week. I don't know how this would work, but I think part of it is also interesting because getting the email, ties into a topic that I had already outlined and we keep pushing forward in our show of purpose in our lives. And it talked about our journey and trying to understand, you know, are we doing the right thing at this point in time right now? And also kind of how what has happened in the last couple of years, how I'm still struggling with some of my PTSD and depression aspects, how it's having a negative impact in some aspects of my life, which therefore then has a negative impact on those who are around me all the time, be it Jennifer and the kids and those who have to deal with this thing. Because I sometimes feel like we're climbing out of a hole, and sometimes I feel like I get pushed back into it again, and then I drag everyone back into it with me. And part of it ties into this story of these last few years. I will give you a quick... So here's the high level, right? So we started Rosier Army, 2005 started podcasting, 2008 went to radio. 2008 to 12, we were on radio. When radio... The year that radio ended, even before it ended, 2012, we haven't gone into a lot of detail that year. I had several panic attacks at the beginning of the year. We had to take an entire week off of work because I wasn't able to broadcast. In the middle of the summer, we realized Jennifer needed to leave the show. We were ready to be canceled. We secretly traveled to other states for job interviews that I don't know if you knew this. And then in September, what we assumed was going to happened and our show got canceled. But we took it upon ourselves and made it sound like it was almost like our decision for the show to end, but it wasn't the case. And so then our show ended in October, and then we were like, what do you want, God? And God directed us, and just this job opportunity for the Archdiocese of Denver kept coming up. I took it. That was okay for a year, but then it went down. And so in my perspective, I have been struggling for the last 8 years to figure out what the heck I'm supposed to be doing with my life. And when it didn't go well in Colorado, after 4 years, I got a job offer in Indiana. I took that. That was even worse. And when that collapsed, that's when we said, let's just go back to Georgia. Let's return back to doing the Rosary Army work. And let's just kind of trust God for a while and see what, not for a while, let's trust God and see what he does. And so, but now we're at a weird place. So there's a lot of gaps in there. And is it worth telling the story? Would you like to hear the story again? Maybe that's the voicemail feedback. Would you like to hear the story again? Or what details would you like to hear more of? Maybe that's what the question is. So if you want to try to tell the story, go for it. But if you want to say, hey, I would really like it if you would give more detail on this, maybe you could help us piece together what are the parts that we need to be most beneficial to everybody to kind of retell that story. Your input would always be appreciated. Record it on a voicemail because we love to hear your beautiful voices. Just pick up your phone, open up your voice memo, record it. Try to keep it 2 minutes or less if possible. And then email it to us at feedback@gregandjennifer.com. If you do that, you could help us make next week's show really interesting. I think we could come up with something very intriguing and a little bit different, using a lot of your voices to tell a story. If I get it early enough, try to send it, let's say, by Friday of this week. If you can send it to me by Friday, I can work on it over the weekend, and then we can see where we can go with that.
If you want to get any swag or t-shirts, like, go over to our willitsworks.com website. If you have ordered Rosary Army t-shirts and are still waiting for the fulfillment of that t-shirt, you are not alone. They are experiencing massive delays on their fulfillment.
It's because of the coronavirus.
Yeah, there's nothing we can do. And I appreciate those who've reached out to us, say, hey, I ordered it on so-and-so. When is it going to come? We have no control over that. It will come. Just please be patient. I'm still waiting on t-shirts myself. We're waiting weeks, and I just have to be fine with that. Just know it will come. And we thank you so much for taking the time to place orders, because it definitely helps our family. And just like we appreciate all of our Patreon co-producers who support this program, whether they want to participate financially through Patreon or if they are more comfortable just on PayPal. We are so happy and grateful for your financial assistance. It really has made a difference to our families, ability to make it through this very unique and unprecedented time that we are in right now.
And as Jennifer said, patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer, that right now is the number one way that we are providing for our family. And so if you are in a position to be able to help us continue doing this work and to focus on praying the live stream rosaries and do the other kinds of media that we're doing, please, please, please consider going over to patreon.com/Greg and Jennifer, and then you'll have instant access to all of the past content that we've made. You'll have access to future digital content that we'll also make that are as available just to our Patreon co-producers. We love hearing from you. Again, show notes and links to everything we talked about over at gregandjennifer.com/327. That's for this episode of the podcast, episode 327. Make sure you're subscribing to the podcast, leaving your reviews at iTunes, supporting us through Patreon, through the swag, sending us your voicemail. And we'd love to thank you. If you need a rosary, if you would like a rosary, go over to rosaryarmy.com. Click on the link to get a free rosary, print out the form, fill it out, send it to us in the mail, and we'll take care of the rest. We'd love to be able to send you your own Altwine knotted rosary and have you be a part of the worldwide rosary army. Until next week,
you are awesome.
And you are not alone. God bless, folks.